So I'm going to talk to you guys about my research around multidisciplinary approaches to coastal adaptation. And so a few months ago, I came across this quote, and it was kind of, for a minute, I was relieved. I said, okay, basically, it was saying the population growth problem is over, fertility rates are coming down, so it seemed like good news. Unfortunately, I kept reading the paper, and that's how it ended. You know now that was wrong. So there's a recent shift on the demographics and the population projections from the United Nations. And while I was doing some research, I came across this crazy picture. This is Rio, Copacabana. So if you're planning a trip to Rio, make sure to check the Pope's schedule. That's what happens when he came to visit. That's roughly what a million people look like. It was like a crazy day at the beach. So right now we're about 7.3 billion. That's recent estimates from last week, 7.31. And when we look at the current projections, we're aiming, about 11.2 billion is the current mean projection for 2100. One of the numbers that kind of scared me as well on this projection is this number here, 8.5 billion by 2030. If you think about it, it's like 15 years away. 1.2 billion people more on the planet. So that's a kind of a scary number to me. And this is a mostly scientists, so I decided to keep the confidence intervals in the slide. So this is like the 80% is the like thicker dotted line. So even if we end up at the lower end here of the projections, we're still looking at about 10 billion people. And we tend to live in places that are like this, right? Who wouldn't live like near the coast and some of these areas that are really unfortunately exposed to some of these coastal hazards, things like hurricanes and storm surges. So from 2008 to 2014, on average, there were 26.4 million people displaced by these coastal hazards, and about 85% of that number, right? 85% of displacement happens in developing countries. And 14 out of the 15 largest events that caused such displacement were related to floods and typhoons. So just to give you some idea, 26.4 million, that's about 8% of the population in the US. So if we add up the top 10 cities in the US by population, we have about 25 million people. So imagine having that large number of people being displaced every year, and impacts on economics and livelihoods and all of that. So, thankfully, we have options for the future. We can do some sort of mitigation, which is basically reducing CO2 emissions. So we're looking at future impacts from climate change. We can stop trying to reduce emissions, so we minimize future impacts. There's adaptation, which is to change the way we live or where we live, how we view things, where we view them, so we are not as exposed to some of these impacts from climate change. And there's suffering. So the more we do of the first two, the less suffering we'll have to endure. But I think, unfortunately, we're already coping with, a little bit of the three. And that's kind of what motivates my research, is looking at adaptation. What can we do to, become safer and try to protect ourselves from some of these impacts from climate change? But one of the things I keep finding is that I'm really interested in climate change, so I took all this climate dynamic classes and weather prediction and wave energy and trying to learn all these things. But every time I get to my research, I find out that things are already at a state that we need to adapt. So all my research is really based on current weather and current climate and current population. But one day I'll get to the climate stuff that I want to do. So this is an introduction to my study. I am doing a comparative risk assessment and looking at adaptation alternatives for coastal communities across Latin America and the Caribbean. And this project started with this great data set that I got from, that came from this project that was from the Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean, when they were looking at the effects of climate change on the coasts of the region. And they produced this incredible data set. If you look closely, there's this tiny, those are centroids or like circles. They represent like a 5 kilometer coastal area. And for each one of these areas, this data set started with a lot of data for related to the coastal hazards. So there are things like wave energy, wave heights, storm surge. but also some characteristics of the exposure of the number of people living under 10 meters and size of the urban area or croplands. So when I got hold of this data set, I set out to do the study where my idea was to classify all these points, and there are 15,000 of this little centralized across the whole study area. So I'm using some machine learning and clustering algorithms to try to group these areas according to their coastal vulnerability, but also where you could apply similar adaptation options. So I started looking for hotspots of vulnerability, trying to understand what are the drivers of risk, and then finally looking at adaptation strategy. So back in 2012, the IPCC, which is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change from the United Nations, they proposed this framework to assess risk. So there was a special report on extreme events that they published. So basically they talk about risk as a function of hazards, which is your climate events, your hurricanes, storm surges, etc., but also as a function of exposure, which is the presence of people, assets, ecosystems, or something that you care about on the path of these hazards, but also vulnerability and socioeconomic conditions of the coastal populations that are being affected. So in my study, I'm looking at the hazards side, so I'm looking at things like wave energy, storm surge, the El Nino. El Nino, it was a big one recently. And the sea surface elevation, actually, it rises. We had sea levels that were about a foot higher than normal during the last El Nino. The same happened in 1997-98. Wave height and winds. And then on the exposure side, for those 15,000 centroids that I mentioned, I added some of these attributes to them as well. So looking at GDP, population under 10 meters, urban area, crop area, and some ecosystems as well. And finally, on the vulnerability side, I'm looking at inequality, infant mortality rates, child malnutrition, and then an inverse measure of GDP. So basically, the idea here is that the lower the GDP, the higher the vulnerability is, compared with other coastal communities on the same area. So I have just two slides about my methods, just so you guys have an idea how I went about doing this. So I started with 15,000 centroids with the attributes of hazards first, and then I applied this clustering techniques. And just so if you guys are interested, we can talk later about this, but I'm using self-organizing maps and k-means or the algorithms. I know some folks in the DNA sequencing also use similar things. And then I ended up with from 15,000 to 9 groups. And then for each one of the 9, I rank them according to severity from 1 to 5. So there are some areas where El Nino and strong winds are combined, so they would have a higher severity as far as hazards go than other areas. Then I did the same thing for the exposure data set and the vulnerability data set. And then in the end, I ended up with 3 sets of rankings from 1 to 5. And when I follow that framework proposed by the IPCC, I multiply the hazards exposure and vulnerability rank, and I end up with a risk index. That each one goes from 1 to 5, so when I multiply them, I get a ranking that goes from 1 to 125. And that gives me the first thing that I was looking for, which is what are the hotspots on this region. So you can see here on Central America and Ecuador, those are kind of came up at the top according to the indices I developed. There's about 250,000 people in this area, and Ecuador is about little under half of about 102,000. I was just reading this morning there was a 7.8 earthquake off the coast of Ecuador last night, so there's some little worry because I'll show you what are the drivers of risk in this area. So the one good thing about doing this clustering analysis is that I keep track of the variables that drive each one of the different categories. So when I look at those hotspots, I find that El Nino and strong winds are the major drivers of hazards. When I look at the exposure for that region, it's a combination of large population and urban areas, but also some sand beaches and crops. And the exposure, as we look at the socioeconomics of the region, is really an area of extreme inequality, very low GDP, very high mortality rates, and malnutrition. So the message here and kind of the idea that I'm proposing housing, and it's not new, but that's what the approach I developed kind of follows this process, is really that if you're looking at adaptation and to coastal hazards, and it being that current hazards or future hazards from climate change, you have to look at things from an integrated point. So you do have to focus on coastal defenses. So like like the STEMP idea from Dr. Myers. So you start with the science, and the science will really help us to understand the coastal hazards and what coastal engineer, you figure out what the best, you can do the seawall or what you can do. But also, you can also look at gray solutions. So those are things like restoring mangroves that could act as buffers for some of these hazards and things like that. But then you got to start looking at policy options. You got to look at reducing your exposure. So things like managed retreats. So you find areas that are the most vulnerable, and then you start slowly moving away from those risk areas. Not many examples of that yet, but I suspect we'll see more of that in the future. You can look at different zoning, infrastructure planning, where we build, and some of these big infrastructure projects that have a 20-year lifespan. The next time that you will have to upgrade these power plants, for instance, maybe look at putting them at a different spot. But also, you can't really do proper adaptation if you don't focus on reducing vulnerability. So you really got to look at sustainable development, health, education, early warning system, and things like that really help to protect and make this communities more resistant and resilient. Some acknowledgments and also that, and that was it. Thank you very much.